Way out east, there was a fellow I want to tell you about. He called himself the Dude. Now, Dude, that's a name no one would self-apply where I come from. But then there was a lot about the Dude that didn't make a whole lot of sense to me. Maybe that's why I found him so darned interesting. Now, the story I'm about to unfold took place back in the early 90s, just about the time of our conflict with Saddam and the Iraqis. I only mention it because sometimes there's a fish. I won't say a hero, because what's a hero? But sometimes there's a fish, and I'm talking about the Dude here. Sometimes there's a fish who, well, he's the fish for his time and place. He fits right in there. And that's the Fish Dude on Game Boy Works, episode 96. Every system worth its salt on the collector's market has its holy grails, games that have become so vanishingly rare or expensive that they become the impossible stumbling block for anyone hoping to build a complete run of that system's library. Even Virtual Boy, which didn't even see 24 official releases all around the world, has several games that run upwards of $1,000. And Game Boy 2 has its own chase pieces. They're not as well known as, say, the NES's grails. Anyone who has been collecting much has heard of Little Samson, or Panic Restaurant, or Surprise at Dinosaur Peak. Earthbound? Banal. Rendering Ranger? Trite. Game Boy grails, on the other hand, they tend to get a lot less press. Because who actually cares about Game Boy? It's always been the forgotten child, the system for kids, the second stringer. So its most prized releases tend to be far less known. Maybe you've heard of Avenging Spirit and Kid Dracula, but what about the really weird stuff? Stuff like Sumo Fighter, or Burning Paper, or Bombsay. Games that would sell complete for $1,000 if complete copies ever went up for auction, which they don't. And what about this little, gem, Fish Dude? Fish Dude perfectly embodies the essence of the Game Boy Holy Grail. I've had my eyes peeled for complete auctions of the game for years, and in all that time only one has hit eBay. One! And I missed out on it. That's why I featured the Japanese packaging here. While the cartridge and manual were lent to Game Boy World by Armin Ashekian, I've been unable to track down the US box for the game despite casting a net far and wide. It's not that it's a particularly precious or worthwhile game, it's just one that no one owns. And it's not hard to understand why. I mean, this game is called Fish Dude. It really comes off as a game for which a team of marketing people looked deep into their souls and asked, how can we make this game sound as unappealing as possible? It's too bad, really, because over in Japan, Fish Dude has a great title, Uozu. A little cumbersome for American tongues, perhaps, but a great linguistic pun that plays off the Japanese word for fish and the Japanese pronunciation of the English word wars. But over here, we just got Fish Dude. There's not really much to the game. It consists of 9 stages, making it about as slight as Mr. Chin's Gourmet Paradise, though a lot less toothless. On the contrary, Fish Dude is as ridiculously difficult as Gourmet Paradise was aimless. Even getting through the first stage can be a test of skill and patience, as the game world is populated by deadly foes who pursue poor Fish Dude and will devour him aggressively. So here's the basic breakdown of the action. You control a tiny fish swimming around through underwater mazes, attempting to devour a set number of tinier fishes so you can grow to your next evolutionary state or whatever. Meanwhile, you need to dodge ravenous larger fish who hope to eat you in turn. It's kind of like Pac-Man, except brutally difficult. The camera viewpoint is zoomed in extremely close to the action, and everything moves at a ridiculously rapid clip, which means enemies can appear from off-screen and be on top of you within a split second. To make things even more difficult, it takes Fish Dude a moment to gulp down a victim, leaving you motionless and defenseless as you masticate. If you accidentally bump into a little fish while evading a bigger one, you're basically dead as your jaw flaps pathetically on your unwanted meal. And while you can spit out a fish without eating it to save time, everything happens so quickly there may be no chance to do so. You can also evade the big fish by leaping out of the water, but this mechanic also falls athwart of the zoomed-in viewpoint. Seagulls and boats, crewed by hungry kittens, patrol the surface of the water, and the cramped camera means that you may not realize danger lurks above until you've leapt from the water and it's too late. The premise of eating enemies to grow to the next stage of evolution has been explored in quite a few other games, such as EVO for Super NES, Cubivore for GameCube, and the early phases of Will Wright's magnificent flop Spore. It's never been done as unremarkably as it was here, though. The growth mechanic actually works to your detriment. The further you venture into the game, the larger Fish Dude grows. This leaves you less room for evasion and makes it harder to slip between narrow spaces to safety. It's kind of clever, but also kind of frustrating. It's worth noting, though, that Fish Dude does offer you one advantage. You have a friend in the form of octopi that live in several stages. When you bump into an octopus, you'll cause the screen colors to invert. I guess that's meant to represent ink being sprayed into the water. And while the colors are messed up, you're briefly safe from the big fish. And finally, in the ninth and final stage, the game becomes what the manual refers to as a death match, wherein it's just you and a few big fish swimming around trying to dodge a human diver while turning the tables on your foes. If you can chomp a big fish's tail here, you can eat it. Gulp down three of them and you win, game over, with the option to play again at an even higher difficulty level. And that's the entirety of this game. Not much, right? It's not the worst thing ever, but it's also nothing to write home about. Certainly not the kind of game that should cost upwards of $50 on the aftermarket for the cartridge alone, but, well, that's the thing about Fish Dude. It's wildly expensive because really, who would have bought this game back in the day? It has a terrible name, unengaging box art, a middling premise, and hails from a trio of almost completely unknown, under-the-radar corporations. So far as I can tell, its reputed developer, Salio, produced a grand total of 4 games in the course of its brief existence on this earth. The most interesting thing about those 4 games is that 2 of them were licensed from Tecmo and comprise the only 2 third-party titles ever to be published on Sega's Mark III console, the Japanese equivalent to the Master System. Fish Dude was the company's 4th and final creation. Japanese publisher Toachiki we've already seen on Game Boy Works as the company behind the perfectly mundane classic board game adaptation Taikyoku Renju. Fish Dude would also be the final game from Toachiki. In fact, the only company that appears to have survived the creation of Fish Dude was US publisher Sofel, one of the nobodies of the 8-bit era. If they're known at all, Sofel is probably best known for the Casino Kid games, which apparently are pretty decent. After releasing Fish Dude here, the company's US branch would go on to publish Z-tier NES titles Clash Ball and Dragon Fighter, as well as TKO Super Championship Boxing for Super NES. Then they'd retreat back to Japan-only publishing before fading from existence a few years later. Yeah, there's really nothing happy in the Fish Dude legacy. It's an unremarkable game created by doomed companies, and you can expect to pay dearly for the questionable privilege of playing it. About the only thing Fish Dude really has going for it is the fact that its US branding and marketing are the platonic ideal of the garbage The Simpsons would make fun of a few years later with the episode The Itchy and Scratchy and Poochie Show. My planet needs me. Sadly, Salio died on the way back to its home planet. Next time on Game Boy Works, why couldn't SD Gundam have died on the way back to its home planet?
How you doing there, dude?
Not too good, man.
One of those days, huh? Well, as a wiser man than myself once said, sometimes you eat the shark, sometimes the shark, well, he eats you.
That's some kind of Eastern thing?
Far from it.